Tonight on the Bigfooty Podcast, we talk all things Adelaide with specious argument. We take a look at the run home and who's going to make the finals. We make our finals predictions. Later on in the program, we talk to the prosecutor about the Dean Robinson interview, and Messenger sings us a lullaby. All this and more coming right up.
Hello, is it me you're looking for?
Good evening and welcome to yet another episode of the Bigfooty Podcast. I am, of course, the Wookiee. With me are my compatriots, the Old Duck Navies.
Say that again. Black Ops?
and Messenger has joined us finally.
Whatever it takes.
And joining us tonight to talk all things Adelaide is Specious Argument.
Everyone's favourite fella from across the border that's not actually across the border.
Excellent. And there are many ferals over here, let me tell you, Specious. I am, unfortunately, in Adelaide, the black hole of the universe that is slowly sucking the life out of me.
How are you feeling now that Tex Walker shaved his mullet off? Has it increased the class of the place at all?
No, we still have Michelangelo Rucci, so...
I like to refer to him as the Roach.
Yes, so do all of us, when we're not calling him other names that are perhaps less complimentary.
Specious, Michelangelo Rucci also doubles as Wookiee's safe word when he's out and about. Michelangelo!
All right, and of course Chief isn't here tonight. He is off conducting, you know, one of his worldwide safaris or tours of theme parks or wherever he might be with his David Attenborough impersonations or his Leyland Brothers thing or whatever he's doing.
Face down in the Mojave Desert.
He spent last weekend in a sand dune with 10 men.
Bindi Irwin. Yeah, whatever he's doing. Anyway, when he's not here, he deserves it. And of course, Prosecutor will be joining us later on. He's currently fixatedly watching the Dean Robinson interview, and he'll be coming back and giving us some updates on how that went and what his thoughts are of the undoubtedly huge revelations that are going to come out of that. And Messenger can
we'll
tell
give
us
you live updates on this as we go on the Bigfooty Podcast, because we bring the fire.
And Messenger will tell us all about how much he loves Luke Darcy, no doubt. So,
play that again.
There's bound to be fun for everyone. All right, guys.
I just love the way he goes about it.
There's bound to be some highlights and memorable moments from the weekend, and so Specious Argument, what was your highlight from the weekend?
Oh, look, for me it was Ricky Henderson's goal from outside 50 on the boundary line, one step, clear defence. If you haven't seen it, look it up.
Okay, I'll be sure to do that. The Old Dark Navies, what was your highlight from the weekend?
Has to be Jeremy Cameron. 7 goals really scared the bejesus out of the Magpies for 3 quarters. I'm sure we were all sitting there hoping that they would go on with it, but alas, they can't run out a full game. But real insight into what we can expect in the future. He's an absolute gun, that kid.
Yeah, and no doubt about it. I was particularly fond of the way he basically told the Giants not to bother recruiting Buddy. Which Messenger will like. Messenger, what was your highlight from the weekend?
My highlight? Well, I can't go past Friday night. I won't lie. I enjoyed that on a number of levels. One, it was a four-quarter performance from Hawthorn. It was their best performance of the year. But also, there's nothing better than giving Essendon a nice smack around the chops. I enjoyed it immensely.
Generated some tears afterwards too, didn't it?
Some tears and some palpitations.
Yeah.
Well, there you go. My highlight from the weekend, another Henderson, of course, Lachie Henderson at Carlton, just having another good week, kicked 3 or 4 goals, just proving himself to be a bit of a powerhouse up forward for Carlton. And, of course, Matty Cruiser, really showing his critics that he is perhaps a little bit more worthy of his high placing in the draft than they expected some weeks ago.
Wookie and the Hendersons.
That's, yes. As
is Florence around? No,
the Henderson kids?
Yes, no. We did actually bring that up before the podcast, the Henderson kids, Nicole Kidman's original version.
Not to date yourselves or anything, guys. Jeez.
No.
Hey.
Some of us have got to be carbon dated. Don't worry about it.
Listen. We thought we only had to explain the 90s when Pross was on because he actually didn't live through any of it. So, but we're going to have the same problem with you, Specious.
Look, I can remember the Crows' first game, but I would have been just in primary school back in 91.
Oh, no.
I noticed one of the comments about last week's podcast was that music, when the music came on, it was like listening to Gold FM. So, you know, I'll be taking suggestions on the music tonight, so, you know, it'll be full of, Eminem and, you know...
Buddy Holly?
The dulcet tones of the Carpenters.
Well, you know,
my mother used to listen to Cat Stevens, you know, when I was a baby.
I was thinking about something like, hello... Is it me you're looking for?
God, I'm glad.
Something like that, but with an Asada thing.
Jeez, I'm glad I'm recording at the moment.
Oh, definitely.
So is this the point in the podcast where you run out of listeners, or
Messenger does his Lionel Richie impersonation? That's moving along. And we're going to talk about Adelaide after the break, and we've got Specious Argument who is ready for that.
We're the pride of South Australia, we're the mighty Adelaide Crows. We're courageous, stronger, faster, and respected by our foes. Admiration of the nation, our determination shows. We're the pride of South Australia, we're the mighty Adelaide.
Guys, we've got Specious Argument on board tonight to talk about all things at the Adelaide Football Club. The Adelaide Football Club perhaps not having the season that they expected, given where they finished last year. They are currently sitting, where are they, 12th on the ladder.
You tricked me. You said we were going to talk about 2012.
They are currently sitting 12th on the ladder with 7 wins and 10 losses. So perhaps not the season that you expected, Specious Argument.
Look, the lower we sink on the ladder, the more teams above us we've beaten, so there's a silver lining. It's about planning for next year by at this point, I think. We've got, as you say, 7 wins. 5 of those were in the first 9 rounds, 2 wins in the second 9 rounds, up to round 18. So we've beaten Brisbane, Bulldogs, GWS, St Kilda and North Melbourne in the first 9. Since then, we've beaten Gold Coast and Geelong. So North Melbourne and Geelong, the only teams above us we've beaten. Fair to say that's not what we expected after last year. Injuries, I think maybe West Coast is the only other club that rivals us so far for injuries. That's been a bit of a shocker. You know, you never want to blame injuries, but it is a factor. Losing Jenkins on the weekend, Sloan's torn his retina. He's out for 2 weeks. We've got Sean McKernan, Taylor Walker, obviously. After losing Tippett, we're just all of our forward tools just seem to be falling off the perch. I don't know what's going on. We lost Gunston, obviously we lost Tippett, so it's fair to say we're struggling this year.
Yep. All right, guys. Opening it up to questions from the wonderfully wise bunch that inhabit this podcast and. Go nuts.
No worries. Look, you just mentioned Taylor Walker, so we'll pick it up there. It was a massive loss. Adelaide were 4th last year for goals. They're 11th this year, so I guess you are missing him a fair bit. However, Tom Lynch, in his 4th AFL season, seemed to be having a bit of a breakout year.
Look, he's having a good year. As I said on the Collingwood podcast, I don't think he's going to win a Coleman. He's not going to be our key forward. But if he's got someone like a Taylor Walker or a Josh Jenkins that's going to take two defenders, I think he'll go nuts as the second or third tall up forward. He's very mobile. He's very fit. He gets around a lot. Sometimes his decision-making isn't all that flash, so he can be a bit frustrating at times. But I think given a few more games, given a bit more run, I think he'll he'll come good. Yeah, more so than he has already, I guess.
Sorry, go, Miss.
I just wanted to turn our attention briefly to last off-season. Not one of the Adelaide Crows' finest moments last off-season. Obviously, the Kurt Tippett issue and the salary cap breaches and the contracts behind contracts. But one of the things that came out of that was Stephen Trigg kept his job. And I think, and I'm probably not alone on amongst non-Crows fans, I think a lot of people were staggered that he managed to do so. What's the background of that? Has he got photos of somebody that we're not aware of, or was it not seen to be his fault? What was the backstory from a Crows fan's point of view?
It's in his contract that as long as we keep Dangerfield, we have to keep Trigg. So we're not getting rid of Dangerfield. No, look, with Trigg, I think you're right. It did surprise a lot of people that he kept his job. There was... Yeah, it's still a very controversial topic, particularly among Crows fans on the Bigfooty board. He has been, in my opinion, he's been a very good administrator for a very long time. It depends on if you separate out the on-field and the off-field performances. Off-field, the Crows have been doing very well. We, you know, have always had major sponsors. We've always had lots of money in the club. We've even had sponsors willing to put money in a brown paper bag. So he's doing something right. But he also is ultimately responsible for that off-field debacle. Now, I was one of the people that said, you know, let's wait and hear the full story before we condemn him. We never actually did get to hear the full story. The Crows told us, wait until the investigation's over. We really want to have our say. We're going to have our say. They then pled guilty and no comment. So it's hard to tell what actually went on and who's actually responsible for what based on that. But, yeah, it is interesting that he's been able to keep his job.
Yeah. Were the penalties more or less than you expected?
To be honest, they were about what I expected. Don't forget, we also got penalised this year for Melbourne's tanking, but we'll leave that one alone. In terms of the two draft picks, I think that was kind of what we were expecting, and that's why we opted out of the draft last year as well, to try and reduce that. No one thought we were going to be shit this year. We were thinking we're going to lose a pick in the 18 to 20 range. Instead, we're going to lose a pick in the 4-6 range, which hurts, but it's where it is. The fine, neither here nor there. $300,000, you know, I'd buy a house, but for an AFL club, particularly one that's quite solvent as we are, it's not that big a hit.
Now, the big one, how do you feel about Tippett now?
Is this explicit rated, this podcast, or...?
Oh, no, iTunes won't like it.
Say what you like. If it needs editing, I'll edit it.
Go crazy.
Look. Tippett is one of my least favourite non-Crows players, of any AFL player, really. I think the way that he left was quite unfortunate. When he left, he texted his mates and said, look, sorry, love you all, mates for life, but I'm leaving. He was involved in, now exactly who was at fault, he was involved in Sydney trying to screw us over in the trade. He obviously, somehow Sydney knew about this clause in the contract that the Crows were denying for so long. My assumption is that him and his father or his manager tipped the Swans in on that, so he was screwing us on the way out. Then again, we did get the use of him unfairly for an extra two seasons, and we nearly made it to a grand final on his boot. So it's, look, we miss him. I think him in the side is better than him not in the side. Did all this not go down? Was he worth $800,000? No, I don't think so. I would have been happy to have him in at $600,000, $700,000. I don't think he's worth $800,000 or $1 million. But yeah, he's certainly not my favourite at the moment.
No.
I'd just like to say too, I think it's a bit mean. It's a bit mean. He wanted to go home to Queensland, and he did that. I mean, I think you need to let him accept that. And also. Also, just by say you said you lost Jack Gunston. I found him. And thank you very much.
You're welcome. Look, hey, we picked up Brad Crouch as part of that deal, so we'll see who's laughing in a couple of years.
And you know what? That was actually my next question, because he was it wasn't part of that deal. It was a He was a GWS pre-selection, wasn't he? Like a 17-year-old.
The mini draft. Yeah, that's right.
So
we got that pick. I believe. I could be wrong in this, and I hope I'm not making a glaringly stupid error, but someone will pick me up if I do. I believe we traded someone. Oh, here we go. You'll edit this bit out, won't you? We made a trade that involved us getting that and you getting Gunston and somebody else getting something else. I can't remember exactly what it was.
It
wasn't quite the way I remember it. I didn't think they were related. I didn't think they were related trades, but I stand to be corrected on that.
Tippett did create the probably the biggest threat ever on the Crows board, if not biggest individual threat on Bigfooty. We all watched in wonder for a fair while. That was compelling.
Oh, it's still going. I believe we hold the record for the main board at this point.
Over
1,000 odd pages.
Have you seen the Asada threads at the moment?
Yeah, we haven't merged those yet. Well, if you merge them all,
then we can talk. Threads. Have you started merging?
No. I will be now, though.
The road to hell is paved with merged threads, let me tell you.
Anyway.
So how have you seen Crouch this year? Because he came in early, he got dropped a couple of times, obviously spent some... Was he injured, or did he end up back in the sand pool?
I think part of the problem is it took his body a little while to adapt to AFL football. His hamstrings allegedly were a little bit, you know, sore, didn't want to risk him. He's had a few rests. He's had a great game on the weekend. I think he's going to be a great outside mid. But, yeah, I think it's been quite controversial this year, Sando's decision to rest him as much as he has. But we'll see in the long run. You know, if that gets us an extra 20 games at the end, then I think it'll be well worth it.
Mm. Graham Johncock retired mid-season.
Yes. I think it's fair to say he wasn't going to get another game.
He said his body wasn't up to it, didn't he?
No. I think it was his back in the end that was causing him big problems. He was certainly a big contributor for a very long time.
Mm.
We've got quite a few young guys coming through that are going to fit that role, and I think he was a pace too slow. And we wanted to get the games into the younger guys.
Yeah, it's just a shame we're not going to hear people talking about Stiffy as much anymore.
Between that and the retirement of Brad Dick, there's no fun anymore, is
there? Oh, I know. Oh, no double entendres to be had. Sam Jacobs. He's a little bit down this year. Just a little bit. He's sort of about five hit-outs further down. But I've heard Adelaide supporters talking about the fact that he's a little bit off his game this year compared to last year. But just looking at things like, Adelaide were third in hit-outs last year, 13th this year. Clearances, they were second, they're 13th this year. Centre clearances, they're not too far off. But I'm just wondering whether there's any other reason for those numbers sort of declining. Is it down to Jacobs being a little bit off a bit more often, or is there issues in the midfield?
Look, I think it's going to be a combination of both. But with Jacobs, he had a brilliant year last year with a lot of the Crows. And I think he carried us. He gave us first use of the ball. We still do have some very good midfielders. Gave them first use of the ball, and from there we were able to leverage that. This year, he's certainly been off. He's been tired. I don't know if he's carrying a niggle, but he's certainly not got the apparent fitness that he had last year. So he's not performing to the standard he was last year. Maybe it means that other ruckmen are adapting. Maybe he had some tricks that the other ruckmen have picked up on, and now he's just come back to the pack. But, yeah, I think that's been a large part of our performances this year.
And McKernan and Jenkins don't seem to have... they haven't been as good as a backup ruck as they were last year either. Their numbers are fairly down. Who's the
Don't forget, last year we had Tippett as a backup as well.
Who?
Tippett was a backup.
Sorry, I thought he was the next. I didn't know he was an Adelaide player, sorry.
No, we...
That's all right.
You bastard.
No, I've moved on from that. Now that he's playing in red and white and Jesse White's doing better than him, that's all right.
He had to go home.
He lives. I'm in Queensland. He lives just down the road from me.
That's right.
About 10 hours drive.
Commutes on weekdays.
All right, guys. We've got a lot to get through, but do you have any final comments, questions you need to ask?
I have one. Yes. How important is it to put a dent in Port's finals hopes on Sunday?
Oh, look, that's got to be the key for this season now, is just hurting Port. Whatever we can do, undermine them.
We're behind you all the way, aren't we, Will?
Oh, absolutely. How much is it? How much is the rivalry between Adelaide and Port? I mean, it's one of the genuine rivalries. I mean, I live in Adelaide, and there is genuine dislike between the two groups. Do you get that? Like living in Melbourne, do you get that as well?
I still do. I still do. I lived in Melbourne. I lived in Adelaide when Port entered the comp, and so growing up a Norwood boy. I've always hated Port in whatever colour, whether they're Port Power or Port Adelaide or whatever they want to call themselves. Always hated them. And I think it's good because with the SANFL, before the Crows, everyone had an SANFL club. And if you didn't support Port, you hated them. And so now that they've entered the AFL, it's easy because everyone in Adelaide that doesn't barrack with Port in the SANFL can hate Port Power.
Yeah, I really think they underestimated that level of hatred when Port came into the AFL. It was like, yeah, they're here and they're really successful, but no one other than Port people like them.
Yeah, look, for a relatively small market team, they're doing all right. But I think they will always play second fiddle to the Crows.
I don't know. The Suns are bloody close to starting to get to the same level of attendances as Port, aren't they?
Yeah. Any word on whether GWS are going to, Gold Coast are going to be putting banners out on their seats to, hide the fact that no one shows up to their games?
Well, no, because they've got a half-decent stadium and it doesn't look like it's empty.
Yeah.
You know.
I think playing at Adelaide Oval is going to help the Port crowds.
Yeah, you can only hope so. I mean, that's what everyone is banking on. Even the Crows are banking on it, so.
And look, we all want competitive teams and we all want competitive off-field teams as well. So I think if they can pick up with Adelaide Oval, that's going to be good for football in South Australia, just as long as they don't get too good.
All right, so if you could say one thing to your team supporters this year to give them a bit of hope, to give them what would that be?
I'd say the young kids we've got, the guys we've got coming back from injury, 2014 is going to be a fantastic year.
All right, well, good luck with the rest of the season.
Thank you very much.
And, we'll move on.
Just an update from the interview. They finished the interview. They've gone to a panel featuring noted academics, intellectuals, Mark McVeigh and Cameron Ling. And they've asked Vitamins McVeigh, and he said it was hard to watch at times. But I was there, I know the truth, and there are some things I don't agree with.
Of course.
Of course. So, because it was only vitamin C. All right.
On that note, we're going to go to a quick break. Coming up after that, the prosecutor is going to join us. He's going to enlighten us on all things regarding the Dean Robinson interview.
I'm on the drug, I'm on the drug, I'm on the drug I got from Shane Charters today.
I'm drunk in moon, what's not the same? Heroes exported, give us hope. River pushed back the envelope.
Drank the slab, drank the slab, drank the slab. The mobs got drunk, drank the slab.
Guys, we're back here and the prosecutor has joined us. And we're going to talk a little bit about the Dean Robinson interview that he's just finished watching. He didn't stick around for the panel, unfortunately. So we won't know what pearls of wisdom were cast before the swine. Prosecutor, how was it, Matt? What were your impressions? Were there any astounding revelations? Should we be preparing for Armageddon? Is Jesus coming back? What's the deal?
Well, in the James Heard scandal update, it's revealed that Heard sleeps nude in an oxygen tent, which I believe gives him sexual powers. Oh. I've talked to my friend Ian Hankey, and he has assured me that is a half-truth. So that is the latest on the James Heard scandal. And on behalf of Dean Robinson, in the serious business, the biggest thing to probably come out of the interview was the allegations against Collingwood, in which, what do you call it? Heard apparently said that he knew Collingwood was on the human growth hormone, and he knew that because the supplier actually told him about it. So,
his dealer. His dealer.
Oh, well, if you want to use it so elegantly.
Call a spade a shovel, then, shouldn't we?
So Robinson said that Heard said that the supplier told him.
Yeah.
Well, that's credible.
No, this was around the time they were talking about charters, so one could assume that charters might have been providing Collingwood with HGH, or that's what was alluded to anyway.
So out of all of that, your main discovery was that Collingwood might maybe, perhaps, have taken human growth hormone. Nothing of Essendon at all.
No, I think that's the most serious thing to come out of it, because obviously the allegations came out the other day about, you know, Heard having suspicions about Collingwood. But what particularly came out here is that Robinson specifically referenced to Heard. It was mentioned Heard's source on this being a supplier who's actually supplying Collingwood, so that's a bit more serious and all that sort of stuff. But apart from that, it was really just Dean Robinson, you know, the figure of moral superiority coming into the Essendon Football Club, trying to rid it of its boys' club culture. And of course, as he said, who challenges James Heard at Essendon? He tried and it didn't work, and that's pretty much how his story went.
Not even the president gets to challenge James Heard at Essendon, do they?
Oh, they had a hug afterwards, you know, a bit of consolatory hug. You lost. You're retiring, but yeah.
It was more like the Godfather. I knew you betrayed me, Fredo.
That's one way of looking at it for sure.
Not being in the lucky states there, Pross. We're forced to follow this via the Age website.
Riveting.
No doubt, paraphrasing and whatnot. But it seems there are other things come out, such as Denny Corcoran telling Robinson, "You resign or we'll destroy you." Something like that.
I love that sound effect.
and what was the other one? Something about James Heard being injected 30 times with Hexarelin.
30 times. But on the Hexarelin thing, I think the important distinction that needs to be made there is that Robinson said he got that information from Stephen Dank through his lawyers. Again, that's coming from the same source.
It's more hearsay.
Yeah, because he said that Robinson's lawyers asked Dank, and he said that. So I mean, and that's what Dank said earlier in the year. So it's still one source.
So you don't feel like we're any further ahead with this than we were, say, like we're not. No, this interview doesn't change anything about the way the investigation's going or what Essendon fans might think about the investigation.
Well, as far as the actual investigation, I don't think it's going to change anything, because obviously I doubt Asada and the AFL would let it go ahead if it was going to impact on that. So that tells me that, you know, the Asada report is pretty much done and nothing's changing that. Essendon fan perspective, not really, to be honest. Obviously, there's some things there you look at and you wonder, but again, it's one person's story. I mean, one person who's felt like it's been pushed out of the club and all that sort of stuff. So it's not exactly the most stable.
One person who gave 15 hours of evidence to Asada, apparently.
Well, there's that, but the guy has been stood down and pretty much kicked out of the club, so to rely on his sole basis of evidence isn't exactly prudent in this situation. But, I mean,
these
there's not much there's something that comes out every day that contradicts it. I mean, for instance, if we listen to Caroline Wilson, we should have been blaming Mark Thompson for bringing it over from Geelong and all that sort of stuff for 5 months until last week when she said, you know, Thompson was the one who tried to shut it down and everything. So
it's crap. It's crap. Why would I?
But at this stage, yes. There's not much we can actually say because we just don't know.
So
what's these amino acids? 112 different amino acid treatments. Does anybody know what they that Robinson claims no knowledge of that they were billed for? Is that? I don't know if that's anything bad or not, but they seem to be making a point of it.
Saying he was sacked for it, even though he didn't know what they were, but it fell under his budgetary control, so he was pushed out because of it.
Hmm.
Aren't there 112 amino acids in Nutrigrain or something?
All right, so to summarise it...
They're on the Nutrigrain.
Well, I've seen the ads. That is performance enhancing.
Well, I tell you what, if you ordered $60,000 worth of Nutrigrain, you deserve to be sacked.
Turn them all into Trevor Handy.
Where the bloody hell am I going to put it?
Be enough Iron Man food there to turn you all into Terminators, wouldn't it?
Sorry, I just want to ask... Pross, I need to ask something else. I think this is probably the most important question to come out of this interview. It's been noted quite a lot on the boards that noted empty shirt Luke Darcy was given this interview. And there was some concern. Luke has trouble stringing coherent sentences together, much like myself. How did Luke do? Was he okay?
Can you say that again, Messenger?
I said, hey, Luke do? How did Luke Darcy do? Was he okay?
Well, he had this habit of asking Dean to... Can you say that again, Dean?
Oh, sorry.
I was
oblivious. Yeah, I'm sure Wookie will edit it out so I don't look like an idiot.
I'm sure he won't.
I'm sure he won't.
Luke wasn't terrible, but there was one point in particular... Oh, there was two, actually. I don't know how this question got past it, but he asked what did Dank have in his office, and the Robinson replied with he had a fridge and a stainless steel cabinet. Okay, so there's the big scoop.
Oh.
Yep, that was like one of the first few questions. And the other one was he got on his, you know, moral high ground and started preaching about, oh, if someone's back in my day said, you know, here's an anti-obesity drug we want you to have, he would have said no and all that sort of stuff and he would have shut it down. So he did like to do that grandstanding sort of thing, and he did ask Robinson, you know, say that, like, you guys would have seen the Black Ops clip from yesterday, where he's like, you know, say that again. He did that a few times throughout it. And of course, Mark Stevens, for the first 10 or 15 minutes or so of the panel show there, was trying to do his best to get his profile up out of missing that interview, asking all the hard questions.
Did Mark Stevens blink during any part of that?
He might have. He might have.
He's a noted non-blinker.
Ooh, geez. Ooh, that might be on the front page of the Herald Sun then. Ex-employee blinks.
He might.
Basically named Zaharakis as the only dissenter.
From what I understand, David Zaharakis has a crippling fear of needles, which who would have thought that'd be a good thing in the end? But then again, that doesn't say what other players took and all that sort of stuff. So I get that doesn't really narrow anything down. It just says that obviously Zaharakis is well and truly in the clear, but that doesn't make any of the other players any more guilty.
Now, I heard somewhere along the line, and again, I don't watch the news much during the day, but apparently Caro has said that Robbo has something very big to come in the next few days in the Herald Sun. Is that what you understand?
That's the first I've heard of it, to be honest.
I don't know if it's just his lunch menu or whether it's his bar tab. Maybe he's going to change under...
His wife runs.
It could be one of the many things, but... As for what it is, I'm not exactly sure. I could speculate on the nature of it. At a guess, I'd say it's pretty obvious that there's sort of been the battle lines drawn up between Fairfax and News, with the Herd camp obviously leaking favourable stuff to Herald Sun, and the Fairfax obviously going on the warpath. So I'd say it might be something Herd related or Dimitri related. But I mean, it'll be interesting to see what it is.
It makes it difficult when you leak to the Herald Sun because you have to use such small sentences and such simple words.
Yeah. Herd no bad. Herd be Herd, good.
Herd is good and that. Footy is good.
But I can see a lot of people that would be quite disillusioned. It seemed like, you know, if Essendon get off, we're going to have a lot of people disillusioned with football and not just big footy, but just losing people to the game from that perspective. But if Essendon, are punished in the most severe way possible, you're also run the risk of losing a lot of Essendon supporters. I mean, what's the mood? Like, are people suggesting they're just going to give away football disillusioned if Essendon do go down in a big way?
I guess it depends on just what actually does come out in the Asada report, what the punishment is, how debilitating. And there's a lot of aspects, and it's obviously an individual choice, so I don't pretend to stand for all Essendon supporters and all that. Personally, I'll still hang around and all that sort of stuff. And I posted on the Essendon board a thread about the membership for 2014, and that, I guess, if there's one thing that I guess that we've been admired for throughout the time, is that we've been, I hate to use the word because it's annoying, it's a cliche, but as supporters and as a club in general, we've been galvanised over the whole issue, and it seems that, you know, I mean, you just have to look at the supporters with the Stand By Herd campaign, and you have to just look at the players when they're playing off, once they're off the field and all that sort of stuff, that there's a real sense of family, I guess, in the club, and if the club can appeal to that and then bring them closer together, it's actually an opportunity for the Essendon Football Club as well to rebuild with their supporters. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting. It is interesting. I'll be very interested to actually see how the marketing department, the public PR department at Essendon deal with it, because it is a genuine concern. Because obviously, if we're not playing for points next year, or if we have players off for 2 years and James Herd's banned for life or something like that, there is going to be fallback, and it's about managing that and building on that, and it's going to be interesting to see how it's handled.
One of the things you say, I think what you're saying about selling hope if the situation next season's written off is really important. I mean, there's a massive financial implication to Essendon if they are suspended, not just in terms of match day revenue, but also in terms of, you know, their marketing and all their off-field stuff. I wonder how instructive they'll find the Melbourne Storm situation to be, because really, for a team that played for no points for a year, they were pretty competitive. I mean, they had a very good side, but they didn't really drop off so much, and their fans, really, that small group of fans they have in Melbourne, who are that 10,000 rusted on supporters, really rallied around them. They didn't lose too many of them at all.
Yeah, I guess that's what I was sort of going on about with too, as well, with the whole family thing. It's about, if I was the club, I'd be looking at focusing for the membership and all that sort of stuff, because I would use the campaign like Wear Essendon and all that sort of stuff, because it's a fan favourite slogan, and we have a chant and all that sort of stuff that's fantastic, but obviously it's not well known enough. But what I'd be looking to do would be to, if I was the club, I'd be looking to appeal to the supporters this year, because obviously in past years, you know, it's like whatever it takes to, you know, stand with the players and all that sort of stuff. It's, you know, memberships generally are appealing to people to come to the club and help us get there, whereas I think this might be one of those cases where the club's got to appeal to supporters. You know, it's like meet us halfway and all that sort of stuff. So it'd be interesting to see what they do and all that sort of stuff, because I think obviously we've got to be competitive as well, and I think we will be competitive, but I think it's an opportunity as well to Essendon to expand their membership and go back to the roots and all that sort of stuff, and go back to that sort of that real club sense, like for instance, turning Essendon and the VFL and all that sort of stuff and Windy Hill into a social occasion, and really making, you know, your fellow members family and all that sort of stuff, it's an opportunity really, and it's hard because we don't know what's going to happen, all that sort of stuff, and it'll be devastating for the first bit, but what happens happens, and I guess we'll see where our supporter base really stands.
You've handled yourself very well, Pross, and I just want to say that the Bombers, if it does go pretty sour, are going to need pragmatic supporters like you. So, kudos to you, mate.
Yeah, absolutely.
Patting myself on the back.
No, I agree, absolutely. No. And given that you're only 13 years old, I think that's excellent.
I've grown a year since the last podcast.
That's true, we were 12 last week. But you had a birthday, and it was nice to have ice cream cake at McDonald's with you.
Oh, it was fantastic, and I went to the football Friday night, and, you know, I got all dressed up, and I had my badges on, and...
Your duffel
coat. Oh, I sat in the cheer squad. It was fantastic.
Did you leave at three-quarter time like most of the Eston fans?
I had a tantrum. I went home to bed. You know, it was well past my bedtime.
School the next day. It was very important.
We've got to move on, guys, but just before we do, so have you changed, have you had any thoughts on what you think the outcome is going to be when the report's issued?
Fine, definitely. Draft picks, probably, almost certainly. And apart from that, the rest is up in the air.
He's going the distance. He's going for speed. She's all alone in a time of need. Because he's racing and pacing and plotting the course. He's fighting and biting and riding on his horse. He's going the distance. Flashbulbs, no wine. He's haunted by something he cannot define. Bowel shaking earthquakes of doubt and remorse assail him, impale him with monster truck force. In his mind, he's still bribing, still making.
Alright, and our final segment for the evening, and the one that hopefully some guys have actually done some homework for a change. We'll
bring
be...
out the Herald Sun.
I've got the AFL website.
Off you go to the AFL website and whatever else.
Where's their run home section?
We're going to talk about the run home. To the finals, there are four rounds left, including this weekend, and the ladder currently looks like this. Hawthorn sitting in first, Geelong second, Sydney third, Essendon fourth, Fremantle fifth, Richmond sixth, Collingwood seventh, Port Adelaide eighth, and Carlton are still a chance at ninth. Now, anyone below that, I've pretty much ruled out, given that there's a two-game gap between 9th and 10th.
So, hang on. If Carlton do terribly in their last 5 weeks, could they not drop below, let North or the Eagles or the Crows or the Lions in?
Well, I'm not saying that it's unrealistic. I'm just saying that...
It is a little unrealistic. I've worked that out. I've worked out Carlton winning one more game for the year.
Really?
Yeah, no, not saying we will, but I'm saying look at losing to everyone but the Bulldogs, because they're all, you know, it's a lot of 50-50 games, and finishing in ninth, possibly by percentage to the Lions, who've got some easy games, but a shit percentage at the moment. Yeah. So, the chances of Carlton avoiding not going lower than ninth are fairly slim, because West Coast and Adelaide and North have got some hard games.
That's true. All right. So, having looked at that ladder, and having been through the ladder predictor and everything today, I guess we'll look at it round by round and we'll see what you guys think. And we'll take it. We'll take it from there. Now, if you're on the AFL website,
and I am,
and I know you all are, it's because that's how we work around here.
Or as we like to call it, research.
You'll have observed that there are a couple of big games coming up this weekend. Friday night is Essendon and Geelong.
Melbourne.
Isn't it?
Sorry, which round? What round are we
in? Okay, we're obviously on the same website.
I'm looking at round 19.
Round 19, North Melbourne versus Geelong.
That's right.
Essendon play Collingwood on the Twilight game Sunday.
Sorry.
This is going beautifully so far.
Shut up, Messenger.
This is 2013.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. So we got North and Geelong, which I have suggested Geelong should win that.
are you sure?
Just going out on a limb, I'm going to assume.
How far will North have to be in front at three-quarter time to hang on?
Oh, Charles, I wouldn't want to put money on it. I wouldn't want to put money on it, even if they were 10 goals up.
I would. Oh god, that would be funny if they got 60 points in front and still coughed it up. That would be worth the price of admission.
No, so are we going for Geelong on this?
Yeah.
Giants and Melbourne is immaterial to the finals.
No. It's going
to
be one of the best games ever.
I'm taking the Giants for that.
I'm taking the Giants on it anyway.
Jeremy Cameron will make his Coleman assault.
But I would take the Giants, but they tend to take it up to teams that Eddie had, don't they? So,
Is that Skoda?
Yep.
I know, but I mean they've had some good performances that Eddie had against Essendon and Collingwood, where they've been in the game for a long period of time.
They took Hawthorn to three quarter time.
Haven't had any good performances.
All right, so there's a couple of big games. So Hawthorn play Richmond at the MCG.
Hawks all the way then.
So you'd expect Hawthorn.
Massive danger game.
I don't see the Hawks losing between now and the end of the season.
I can see Richmond have given it a good shake and then falling away. Yeah. Kind of similar to, I reckon they'll do it for a half or so. They'll stay in there and then Hawthorn might pull away, but I wouldn't be surprised if Richmond did.
The last time Richmond played Hawthorn, they won by nearly 11 goals.
Yeah,
they absolutely pantsed us.
Did you have Ruffy playing then?
I think he...
No, he would have came back.
He would have been back by then.
Because he came back round one, didn't he? Against Collingwood.
I think the Hawks are playing a different style of foot. Well, not different style, but they're playing a different intensity.
We're better than we were.
That's exactly it. The two teams can't be compared at the same time. Now, West Coast have got the Suns.
That's an interesting one.
Again, probably go
West Coast at home, but you wouldn't balk at the upset, would you?
Ablett, 70 possessions. Ablett will get.
If the Suns get back Prestia and those guys, who missed
Thompson against, as well?
If those guys had played against Carlton, that game might have been a lot closer than it ended up being. If I reckon they could give West Coast a good run for their money, I think West Coast will just win that.
Yeah.
Carlton have got Fremantle.
Oh, hello. Hello.
Yeah.
This is in Melbourne. Hello. It's another potential final shape of this.
If Fremantle win this, I can't see them missing the top four.
No, me either. But if Carlton win this, I can't see us missing the finals. So.
That's true.
As a impartial observer, I don't think Fremantle's going to win this one.
No, I don't think so either.
We are a shocking side at the moment. We pushed them right to the end. Our set shots is what lost us the game. I think if you guys can kick accurately, kick more than 70 points, I think you'll win.
I think our forwards are in a reasonable position at the moment.
I've gone conservative here on my AFL ladder predictor.
Yes.
I've just so I can see what happens. I've put the Dockers in because I know they'll strangle us.
You and I are no longer friends, Odin.
No. My Bigfooty Blues podcast. I'll give a totally different prediction, mate. But I'm being conservative for the purposes of this.
All right. So who are we going for in Carlton Frio?
I've got Frio. I think 10 goals to 7 game. I think the small, sexy, magical joke of Carlton's forward line won't break through across the rough rugged Fremantle backline.
Prosecutor, you're the deciding vote here. We've got 2-2.
I'm going to draw.
You bastard.
Oh, yes.
No, actually, I really don't know. It's an interesting one because I can see Carlton winning and I can see Fremantle winning then.
You must be.
I'll go Carlton.
All right, so we've got Carlton.
It's more
on this.
Beneficial to Essendon.
Brisbane and St Kilda won't really shake the finals.
Brisbane all the way.
Brisbane.
Yep. Bulldogs and Swans will beat the Bulldogs, I think.
Yep.
Yes.
I reckon Bulldogs will have to give a shout, but they won't win it.
Crows and Power.
Oh look, I'd love the Crows to win, but for the purposes of this run home, again being conservative, I'll go Power because they've got something on the line.
Yeah, I've done the same.
I'd love us to win, but I think Power are religious on this one. They've always seemed to have the wood on us in showdowns, even when we're much better than they are. They're always close. So now that they're better than we are, I think Port.
Right. Is Dangerfield back?
He should be. He should be. McKernan's a test, but again, we lost Jenkins and we lost Sloan. So
you got no one up forward.
Yeah.
No. we're going to start playing defenders up forward, I think.
Collingwood and Essendon.
Oh, Essendon.
Yes.
I must say, look, despite the margin on Friday night, I was really impressed with Essendon. I think they're a good football team to watch. I think they'll beat Collingwood comfortably.
Odeon?
Yeah, Essendon, Collingwood, they're not very impressive at the moment, and they're in danger of falling out if a lot of results go against them. Having said that, I'm sort of waiting for something to affect Essendon and, you know, and over this whole saga and seeing if, you know, a collapse comes in the last few weeks.
All right, so at the end of round 19, no change to the ladder that really affects the top 8 or 9 teams.
So we went with Carlton, didn't we?
We did. We went 3-2 with Carlton. So.
Yeah, okay.
All right, so moving in around 20, St Kilda have got Hawthorn. Hawthorn will win that.
I don't think you can pick a big enough margin out of that list.
Yeah, Richmond and Brisbane at the MCG. We'd be going for Richmond, yes?
Yeah.
Geelong versus Port.
Geelong.
Skilled.
Carlton and the Bulldogs.
Carlton.
Bulldogs.
Sydney and Collingwood.
Swans.
Yeah. I'd say ANZ. I'd say Swans, yeah.
Yeah. Suns and Demons will be going Suns, yes. Suns. At Metricom. Essendon will be going against West Coast.
Etihad. West Shivers. Etihad.
Frio against the Giants at Patterson's could be a close one.
Frio. Right. Cameron won't be scoring any goals that week.
Four goals to one. Adelaide and North at Amy Stadium.
That's a close one.
Jeez. Oh, hello. Game of the round.
I could flip anyway on that.
Oh, Christ.
I'll go North.
I'm going North because I think they're a little bit more dynamic. Any North could show up.
All right, so I've got North as well for this. Now, this changes the ladder somewhat in that it would put Carlton up to 7th on percentage unless there's a big win or loss in there. Collingwood would be equal and Port Adelaide would be equal, but Carlton would be up on percentage in that regard. They've got a better percentage now anyway. But Carlton, Collingwood, Port Adelaide would be equal, but Carlton would be in 7th, Collingwood would be 8th, Port Adelaide would be 9th, and Richmond would be a game above them in 6th spot. Fremantle would be 5th. No change to the top 4. heading in around 21, Hawthorn and Collingwood.
Hawthorn.
Port Adelaide and the Suns at Amy Stadium.
Port.
Richmond and Carlton at the MCG. Now,
Richmond.
I've gone Carlton, but, you know.
I've gone Carlton. I think,
I think there'll be some severe revenge.
We only lost by 5 points in round one. And we were...
Richmond it is.
Ooh. Yeah. We got a 2-2 here. Mate. Who hasn't voted yet?
Specious.
Sorry, what?
Richmond Carlton.
Richmond Carlton. Tough one. I want to say Richmond on this one.
Richmond it is.
Richmond it is. We're going to go with the votes. Essendon versus North Melbourne.
Ooh.
Etihad Stadium.
North will be making their valiant run to make 8th spot. I'll say North.
North will be 3 games behind if we're right at this point.
Yeah.
This is North Melbourne's grand final, so...
Yes.
Versus Geelong at Subiaco.
So are we going Essendon or North?
We're going Essendon, I think.
We're going Essendon.
West Coast, Geelong. Geelong.
Yeah. Brisbane and the Giants would be going Brisbane.
Yeah,
Melbourne and Frio at the MCG.
Oh,
yeah. If there was ever a game not deserving of the MCG... But we'll be up for free.
Can you possibly imagine the unwatchable versus the unwatchable?
The abominable versus the unwatchable.
Melbourne are very watchable. They're just not watchable for the right reasons.
The Swans, if ever you
wanted a venue to see if you could prove the myth about ducks quacks not having an echo, that'd be the perfect venue on that day because it'd be large and empty. Yeah,
Swans and the Saints at the SCG would be going for the Swans.
Yes.
And the Dogs and the Crows at Etihad Stadium.
We've beaten them already.
Yeah, but at Etihad and the Bulldogs Etihad, are in a rich vein of form.
I've actually gone Dogs on this one.
No, I'll take the Crows.
I'll go Crows reluctantly.
Crows, I'm outvoted. Carlton move into 8th at the end of round 21. Port Adelaide 7th, a game clear of Carlton. Collingwood are out of the 8. if our predictions are right at the end of round 21. Moving into round 22, lads, and it's Collingwood and West Coast at the MCG.
Collingwood.
Got Collingwood at the G.
Yeah, West Coast will be in full tank mode by then.
It's Crows and Melbourne at Amy Stadium. You'll be in Adelaide.
Yes.
North and Hawthorn at Etihad Stadium.
Ooh. I'll say Hawthorn, but what would
that be? I'll go North.
Ooh.
Oh, is that Etihad?
Oh, jeez.
We've won our last seven in a row at Etihad.
The drugs are well and truly kicked in by the round 22, by the looks.
And the match of the round, you're looking at Geelong and the Swans at Skilled Stadium.
Geelong on Cats.
Sydney.
Yeah,
I'm already outvoted, so.
Yeah, I'm going for the Cats, but anyway.
Can't tip against them at Skilled. I don't care who they play, you can't tip against them there.
Yeah. The Dockers and Power at Patterson Stadium.
Dockers.
Carlton and Essendon at the MCG.
I have, of course,
gone Carlton here.
Again, I don't want to be getting him by being too open. We haven't shown anything, so I'm going to go, for the purpose of the exercise, Essendon.
ODM.
Tentatively going Essendon. Tentatively.
Let's not think we're going to win five in a row on the way home.
I'm thinking it, don't you worry. St Kilda and the Suns at Etihad Stadium.
Suns.
Ooh.
Suns.
Some
who would have thought say that? Anyway.
Giants versus Richmond.
Richmond.
At Skilled.
Doesn't matter.
Skoda.
It could be on the moon, it wouldn't matter.
Brisbane and the Bulldogs. Bulldogs at the Gabba.
Brisbane.
Yeah.
Brisbane.
All right. This has put Carlton in the ninth.
Ooh.
Big game out.
Can we force them out? A game
behind Port, but
leading into round 23.
Port Adelaide playing Carlton.
Yeah,
we've set it up beautifully, haven't we?
We have indeed. Sydney versus Hawthorn at ANZ Stadium.
I've gone Sydney.
Hawthorn.
Yep. We'll send Box Hill up.
That wouldn't surprise me, man.
Well, Hawks will be a game in percentage clear right at the stage.
Yeah. And, not to mention the fact that ANZ is a disgraceful cow paddock that football should not be played on. I'd hate to see somebody do a knee a week before the finals.
Hawthorn might be resting a few by the stage,
I reckon the Swans will win, but I reckon Hawthorn will rest a few going up there for this if they're a game clear.
Yeah.
More than a game clear. The SWAT, St Kilda versus Frio, we'll be going for Frio at Etihad. Geelong versus Brisbane, we'll be going for Geelong. The close one, Port versus Carlton at Amy Stadium, this will decide 8th place. Will absolutely Port. Decide 8th place.
Port Adelaide to do an Essendon of 2009.
What's that?
Port Adelaide to do an Essendon of 2009.
Yeah.
What was that?
Well, to refresh your memory.
Yeah, for Hawthorn supporters out
there...
Sorry,
what drugs did they do in 2009? Sorry.
Oh, we did plenty back then. We just didn't talk about it. Port Adelaide to win an virtual elimination final and get smacked in the first week.
I'm going Carlton for sure on that one. I'm very confident.
I'm going Carlton on that one as well. So we got...
We got a vote.
No speeches? What did speeches say?
Oh, fucking deciding vote again.
Give it to the Crows fan.
Specious.
Come Carlton.
Carlton. 3-2!
I knew having a Crows fan on the panel would be awesome.
West Coast and Adelaide.
Eagles. Adelaide, actually, at that point in the season.
Yeah.
I think you can have most of the players out there in crutches between those two teams.
Yeah, pretty much.
Well, if Adelaide win this, where are we? Ninth. So if Adelaide win this, and say something happens to a team in the top eight whereby circumstances force them to be dumped from the eight, Adelaide would still not make the finals.
No. Adelaide
would actually be the team that came in.
I think that's merciful. I think that's very merciful. We don't want to get embarrassed in finals again.
Essendon and Richmond, probably the big game of the round after Sydney and Hawthorn.
Richmond will be finished by then, Essendon.
Predicting the big fade out?
Well, it'll be the who fades out the hardest at this by this stage.
Right, so Essendon.
Yeah, I'll take Essendon.
We're going for Essendon.
Yeah, whatever.
That's really hard because we're tipping Essendon to win all these games against the likes of Richmond, Carlton, North, sort of that sort of stuff. And I think they're going to drop one somewhere. And that
I
makes...
really wouldn't be surprised if we dropped to North Melbourne at Etihad.
It would not be Richmond. It would not be Richmond they drop it to.
If Essendon win all the games we're predicting, they're finishing third.
Yeah.
Okay? So, but if they lose, drop one of them, they're dropping to fifth.
Yeah. Fourth. It's that kind. No, I've got them, fourth.
If they'd lose one of them, because we still haven't done the Frio one yet.
That's true. Anyway, all right, we get down there.
No, we have. We tipped them to beat St. Kilda.
Yeah,
okay, you're right.
So we've got the Suns and the Giants.
Suns.
Collingwood and North.
Collingwood.
North.
Oh, North would be a decent chance in
now,
that game.
Now, see here, if a North win... puts Carlton back into a North win and
Richmond Carlton.
Okay. No, Carlton would have,
A North win makes it interesting because it makes it
it'll come down to percentage.
I mean, there's a couple of games here that could go either way towards the end of the season.
Collingwood could drop to ninth.
Yeah.
Potentially.
So Collingwood look like the team that's gonna it'll be Collingwood or Port or Carlton that'll finish ninth. And it could be.
I think Collingwood has too much to play for. Collingwood will win that game.
It's going to come down to percentage. So whoever has a big win in the next couple of weeks could really decide it all.
So who's playing an expansion team in the next few weeks is going to decide who gets into the eight?
None of them.
None of them do.
None of them have expansion teams in the eight.
Oh, there you go.
So it's going to be a very 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 interesting.
It's pretty much whoever doesn't lose by. Whoever loses by the least amount in the games they lose.
I can't say
I'm really belting any teams they play.
We'll be going for the Bulldogs in Melbourne, I assume.
Bulldogs, mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that will leave the ladder at Hawthorn, Geelong, Essendon, Sydney for the top four. Fremantle, Richmond, Carlton and Collingwood for the eight. Port Adelaide missing out or getting in, depending on what happens in the next couple of weeks. So that shapes up to be interesting. That would make the first finals to be Hawthorn versus Sydney in Melbourne, Fremantle versus Collingwood at Paterson Stadium, Richmond and Carlton at the MCG. Well, in Melbourne.
Sorry,
somewhere.
Did you say Fremantle versus Collingwood or Fremantle?
Fremantle Carlton.
Carlton.
Not according to the finals predictor.
So Fremantle Essendon, isn't it?
No, that was with North beating Collingwood. Remember?
Wait, hang on. I had Fremantle fifth and Carlton eighth. Did you pick North Melbourne or did you pick Collingwood?
North Melbourne.
Collingwood. What kind of amateur radio do you guys got me on?
I picked Collingwood in that, but I thought we decided.
Yeah, we've got our own version of Ruchi hosting the show.
Hey!
Ruchi, who came third in this ladder?
All right. Essendon came. We've got Hawthorn and Geelong, and Essendon and Sydney first to fourth.
Right.
Fremantle, Richmond, Collingwood, and Carlton bringing up the bottom four of the eight. Now that would make it Hawthorn and Sydney, Fremantle and Carlton, Richmond and Collingwood, Geelong and Essendon for the first series of finals.
All right. Are we going to go through the finals?
May as well while we're here.
All right. So Hawthorn at the MCG.
Yes. Yep. You would do that.
We'd never lose to Sydney at the MCG in a final.
No, you wouldn't do that. Only games in that really count.
You've got Fremantle.
That's right.
Fremantle would play Carlton at Patterson's.
Fremantle.
Now, this game, the fixturing of that will be interesting because I think the first week of the finals is a rugby union test at Subiaco.
I'd say that'd be the Friday night game.
I would imagine.
I'd say that'd be the Friday night game with Richmond Collingwood on the Sunday, and that doesn't work.
No.
That's got to be on the Saturday. Yeah, that's
it. Football in Sydney would have to be the Friday night. Qualifying finals are always on a Friday night.
But if they can't, Fremantle can't. There's three MCG games there, so that would mean Fremantle would have to play on the Saturday. And as far as I'm aware, that's the day the Wallabies are meant to be playing.
And the game couldn't be a Saturday night in any case. It would have to be a Saturday night game. It wouldn't be Saturday afternoon for TV purposes.
I'd say Hawthorn might have to play at Etihad.
Hawthorn would play at the G, but they'd be playing on Saturday.
But then when would Fremantle be playing?
Fremantle will have to play Friday night.
But then there'd be three MCG games within 2 days.
The Fremantle game would be at Patterson's.
Yeah, but then they've still got Hawthorn, Sydney, Richmond, Collingwood, Geelong, Essendon to fit on to on Saturday and Sunday.
Hawthorn would end up playing at Etihad.
Yeah, they would. Whoever plays an interstate team would end up at Etihad. That was always going to happen.
Yeah.
Fremantle would play Carlton to Patterson's. We would be going for...
Fremantle,
which would knock Carlton out of the finals. Richmond and Collingwood would play at the MCG.
Collingwood
finals.
Love to see that game scheduled at Etihad.
So we're going Collingwood.
We would go Collingwood in the finals.
Okay.
That would knock Richmond out, and Geelong would play Essendon at the MCG. You'd assume.
Geelong would win.
And Geelong, yeah, would easily win that.
Assuming Essendon's there.
Well, that's another story.
We're working in that fictional world right now.
Sydney, which would make the semi-final Sydney versus Fremantle at ANZ.
Sydney just.
That would
Sydney
actually
by much.
That this would become a nightmare for the AFL actually, because scheduling these games at ANZ would put them directly into conflict with the NRL for the second week in a row, and I don't think they'd win that. So this would be at the SCG, I'd expect.
Why couldn't it just be at the SCG? It's a better ground.
The finals are contracted to ANZ.
How long for?
I believe it was extended to 2014.
Oh, who? No.
What a disgrace.
So
Sydney?
So, yeah, we'd go Sydney either way anyway, whatever, wherever it's played.
Yes.
This would be a Sydney game. That would knock Freo out. Collingwood would play Essendon in what would be a fairly decent semi-final.
Essendon.
And we'd be going, would we?
Yeah, I'm going to take the Bombers.
All right, so...
They're a significantly better team on the MCG than we are at Etihad.
I'll go Collingwood on that one.
I'd have to go Essendon if they're there at the time. Hawthorn would play Essendon in the preliminary final.
Essendon.
Really?
Hawthorn.
By 100.
And Sydney would play Geelong in Sydney.
No, they'd play them in Melbourne.
I will say that Geelong will beat Sydney in Sydney.
No, they're not playing in Sydney.
No, they're playing at the MCG because Geelong beat Essendon in the first week.
That's not how this reads.
No, that's,
it reads stupidly, but it'd be Geelong because they won the 2v3 game and Sydney lost to Hawthorn.
That doesn't show.
It would be in Melbourne, that game. Yes, Geelong will win.
Well,
yes.
Then they should fix this bloody...
No, they don't show the home team first.
Well, that's fucking moronic.
It is moronic, but it's the AFL, so we live and deal.
So we'd be looking at a Hawthorn Geelong grand final?
We would.
Yep.
And
for a change.
And Geelong would win.
Would
so...
win
and I think with the deliberate rush behind us, we're all Hawthorn going to lose. Anyway.
And you know what? It will take about 5 years off my life expectancy if that comes up.
All right, guys. Well, that's our prediction here from the podcast panel tonight. We're predicting a Hawthorn Geelong grand final. Thank you very much for coming on board. We're not going to have time to do things that we look forward to on the week. No, fuck it. We'll do it anyway. Things we look forward to on the weekend. There's going to be some severe editing of some stuff anyway, so. What are we looking forward to on the weekend, guys?
I think we got there anyway. I'll quickly say GWS in Melbourne. It's going to be like a car crash. I won't be able to look away. But at least Cameron can get fed the ball about 50 times and hopefully get further up the Coleman list.
Yeah, Odie, Messenger.
I'm actually going to get to go and watch Hawthorn a home game in Melbourne live for the first time in about 8 weeks. We play Richmond. It should be a cracker.
Should be prosecutor. What are you looking forward to, mate?
Oh, shit. I don't know. I'm looking forward to a good week of football before next week is absolutely terrible.
Yeah.
Fixture-wise, anyway.
Yeah. And specious argument, what are you looking forward to?
Scott Thompson beating the piss out of a few Port players.
All right, guys. Thank you very much for your participation tonight. Thank you very much to those people who stuck around to listen. We shall be back next week. In the meantime, good luck with your teams on the weekend. And be polite and love each other on the forums.
Hug your kids.
I think you're being a bit delusional there, guys. Come on,
say that again.
Or was it
Denial. I mean, Donial.
I hope you weren't recording this, Wookie. I hope this is all Black Ops, mate.
All right, guys.
See you next year, guys.
We'll see you all next week.
See ya.
See ya.